things we have to come across first before we can even deal with men and women today is the women's turn. Last week it was the gentleman's turn, but how women are different. All right? We talked last week that there's some differences in women, but I put this one up just to show you. Men have the basic colors of the rainbow. Women have like 3,500 different colors. You say pink, and she's got about 200 choices to what pink means. So when you're saying, I would need it explained, and explain my reasoning, it's because her mind is going here, but what is category is this. And he's going, it's this. And she goes, no, but what subcategory is this under? And so because of that, we're going to look at some of the things this week that are that help women and men in the relationship to understand each other, but also how to do this thing with marriage. All right, to go back to first do it, you have to start at the beginning. So what happens? Then the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. All right, so he's made all of creation. He's got stars, galaxies, nebulas. He's got plants, sun, moon, and stars. He's got light and oceans. And all of a sudden, he makes Adam. Yeah. All right, he makes Adam. And he's got this beautiful garden. And he says, you know what? It's not good for you to be alone. I'm going to make you a helper suitable. A helper suitable. So what does he do? In God's infinite wisdom, he makes every other animal on the face of the earth. All right? He makes the aardvark and the elephant. And he brings them to Adam to name them. And so he can literally see, one, he's got rulership because he's naming the animals. When you name something, you have rulership over it. So this is biblical. And so he brings all the animals in. What, by the time he got to the duckbill platypus, right about that, I'm thinking this is where Adam is going, this isn't working. There's not one here that is sort of for me. And so as he's coming through and he's naming them, there's an obvious not fitting. Creation is still not yet good.
Do you think there was ever a point that got tired of me?
No.
The aardvark sounds good. Anteater? I think
yeah,
got tired.
But some of them got, you know, kind of boring. They could fly.
So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh at that place. The Lord God fashioned into woman the rib which he had taken from the man, and brought her to the man. Now, I want you to catch this, right? Man was made out of dirt. Woman is made out of bone, all right? I'm thinking there has God used something that was strong to be able to do the job that she's going to be designed to do, all right? Also, and this is an old Jewish rabbi saying, that she was not taken from his head to rule over him. She wasn't taken from his feet to be trampled on. She was taken from his rib near his heart to be literally under his protection and close to his heart forever. So that beautiful old Jewish proverb gives the idea of that she is taken from him. But now you have the most beautiful marriage scene ever in history recorded. Come on.
Move on.
Come on, okay.
It's okay.
All right, so now God is literally going to bring her to him. All right, now can you imagine this bride, ready? Absolutely gorgeous, never had a day of acne in her life, brand new created. She hasn't had to have her tips frosted, she hasn't had to have her nails done, she hasn't had any unsightly weight gain. I mean, this girl never went through the freshman 40 or 20 or whatever it was that you had. All right, this girl is beautiful, brand new creation, all right? And so, the man, he brings her to her and God himself walks her down the aisle. I mean, God creates a garden. Forget the little flowers on the end of the pews. This is the garden walking through. God himself is bringing her to her husband and performs the ceremony. And instead of the chuppah with the little tent, now you have literally, I mean, the birds singing, you've got the flowers, you've got the trees, you've got the gorgeous, I mean, can you imagine like a perfect sunrise or sunset? This is the best wedding that was designed in creation. Here we have, it's absolutely gorgeous. And he looks at her as like, whoa! The man said, this is now bone of my bones. Literally, you're taken from, you're part of me, and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. All right?
I have a different theory about the rib.
Go ahead.
I think it was the one that blessed her mom.
That could have been. That could have been. However, this is what's interesting. She shall be called woman. Wait a minute. We just saw a few verses earlier that God named a bunch of animals. And he showed rulership over those animals, a headship, if you will. And so here, God is making that perfect helper suitable. Because literally, after he's made woman and man, God's going to say, this is very good. In other words, it's not good. Everything was good in creation. Oh, light and day, good. Sun, moon, and stars, good. Grass, good. Oceans, good. Flying creatures. And all of a sudden, he comes and he says, there's something that's not good. And that was Adam alone. Man alone is not good. All of a sudden, he makes her, and now God says, this is very good. So I say this in Genesis 1:31. Everything is very good. In other words, women, you are, ready? The perfect topping to creation. The absolute perfect completion. That is an awesome place to be. The perfect topping to all of creation is your wife. That's the perfect finishing to you. Your first perfect completeness because you're one. However, nowhere, and some people have thought this, is because of Eve that there's supposed to be submission or rulership. For the last 15 to 20 years, I've been teaching youth ministry at this church. And we've had Bible studies with young high school women, about 20, 25 girls in our home and doing sleepovers. And the girls would all of a sudden bristle if we ever talked about submission. That's such an evil word. If I ever meet Eve, I'm going to squarely punch her in the face. And I'm like, but sweetheart, I said, submission was an idea before the fall. Adam named Eve just like he named the animals. There was already going to be a headship. That was not part of the fall. There's some other problems that are going to be part of the fall, but that's not it. Just like God said, man was made to work. That was before the fall. And he said, your work is going to be greatly multiplied, Adam, because you sinned against me. But man was made to work. We were never made. Sorry, gentlemen, but you were never made to sit in your boxers and play video games all day long. It just was not part of God's plan. And so instead, he said, it is women's role, ready, to be that perfect helper suitable. You're looking at that one. However, it was already planned from the beginning. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Now, this is important. Leave his father and his mother. Now, that also goes for her, all right? Because, now there is an idea here, right? There is a separation, and sometimes you need to move far in that separation. Lance and I were first married. We lived in South Carolina, close to his parents. We're now 750 miles away.
It's a little more comfortable.
Right? And we love his parents. We go see them every single year.
I'm not sure 700 miles was needed, but there was a certain amount of distance, maybe.
Right? And now we live close to my parents. And my mom is wonderful, awesome. And my mother and my husband have this great relationship, and it's wonderful. But he'll even tell her, Paul, it's time to go home. And she goes, are you upset or mad? He goes, no, it's just getting late, and I'm ready to go to bed. It's time to go home. And in the beginning, she may have felt a little, well, he's just upset with us. And I'm like, no, you have to understand, there has to be some distance. There has to be some leaving so we can be cleaving and spend some time together. So you need to go. And there's nothing wrong with that. Because this joining is two people who are going to be one. But not just physically, but emotionally, psychologically. So what happens to that leaving and cleaving when all of a sudden I am upset and instead of talking to him, I go run to her? Or let's say my cousins, I've got a whole bunch of them in this church, so we're sitting there talking, instead of me talking to him about a problem, all of a sudden I'm not leaving very much and my family's sort of all in your face. There's like a whole bunch of them, they're always around. And so with that, there has to be some definite separation. I'm with him, we're a team now, it's us, and you guys are there.
And if I feel like we're having to have a discussion and we're getting too many phone calls to the help group discussion, then I'll be like, all right, put the phone on me. It's happened.
Okay.
Not frequently. But.
God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Now, this is important. Hey, come on. Some people have this concept that female submission or wife submission or the concept of rulership or headship means that she is less. No. Paul is very clear. He said there is no male nor female, no Jew nor Greek. So, in salvation's eyes, is literally, there's equality. In the image of God, ladies, you are made just as much in the image of God as your husband. So that has nothing to do with it. So, literally, you are equals, but there is going to be a headship there. And this is where all of a sudden the women start to bristle just we said, women, you already were going to have a form of headship. Just like Christ is head of the church, Christ is the head, the church is the body, the husband was going to be the head, the woman was going to be a helper with him, but still under him. But here in the garden, something's going to happen. It's going to change up that perfect dynamic. I can't imagine how beautiful marriage would have been without the fall, because maybe it would have been so much more peaceful. There would have been a lot less, you know, late nights. When we get to anger, we'll talk about one of our biggest rules is you don't go to bed angry or upset, so don't let the sun set on your anger. And there have been times, like, I can't sleep, and he's already, you know, snoring. And I'm still up, and it's 2:30, and it's 3 o'clock. I'm going, I'm not fixed yet, you need to get up. And he goes, but I have to work in the morning. I said, I don't care. You should have dealt with it before you went to sleep. And sure enough, by about 3:30, he's finally awake, and he goes, okay, I'm up, let's fix it. And we fix it, and by 4 o'clock in the morning, I'm like, okay, I'm fixed now, I'm ready to go to bed. And I'm off, because I now have peace. And he is like, I'm up now, I can't go back to bed. So, can you imagine what life would have been like before the fall, how God really designed headship? The idea of a couple working together in unity as a helpmate, as a true helper, as a true couple, equals in the image of God, but peaceful. However, what is this one going to do? So, there is a part of the curse that goes to Eve. Genesis 3:16. Oh, yes. Not yet, though. To the woman, he said, I will greatly multiply your pain in childbirth. Right there, that's the one we have to really thank you for. And I'm looking at Elizabeth, who's done this like five, six times. I'm sitting there going, twice was enough. Okay. In pain, you will bring forth children. Yet your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you. I highlighted the word desire, because that one's the one that's a little controversial. What does this mean? Now, we already got the childhood part and the cramps, and thank you so much, Eve. But this idea of your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you. Now, the rule over you, that was already sort of part of creation. He was the one that named Eve. There was already going to be a headship there. That was nothing new. So this thing that's new is your desire will be for your husband. Now, so I had to do a little look up in the Hebrew to see, you know, exactly what the word meant. And there's some, it's used two different ways. In the Song of Solomon, it actually is talking about desire from a husband to a wife. Same word, right? However, one chapter after this, and this is the first time it's used in Scripture. Yet your desire will be, this is Teshuva, all right? So get your desire, and just flip over. The next time we see the word desire, and if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. He's talking to Cain. Cain, who is ticked at his brother. Cain, who is actually not just so upset, he's actually getting murderous for his brother. And its desire is for you, but you must master it. This concept, this Hebrew concept of desire here, is that it's about to overshadow you. This rule, this desire, is sin that is ready to crouch at you and attack you. Now, all of a sudden, if I head back for a moment and get the, if I have that idea that sin is waiting to overtake me, waiting to throw me, waiting to sit there and mar our relationship, and this relationship to the point of death, then when we look at this here, this word desire, and it's sort of so close in context, we sort of have to see the connection, isn't it doing the same thing? Women. This is where all of a sudden we don't like to admit this very much, but when we know our husband needs to turn a certain way or do something with the finances, like, honey, we know what we're talking about, you need to listen. And they're like, no, I've got it, babe. Yes, but you're doing it wrong. And I will help you and I will correct you if you sit and listen and just do what I tell you to do. And is that our thing? However, that's my desire, my sinful way of leading into. Now, has God given me wisdom? We're going to talk about that in a moment, how men can deal with the wisdom that God's given you. He's given you a helper. But there's a point where he is the head. It's not always easy, but he is the head. But my sinful desire here, my desire is to actually take that rulership from him. And that's the danger. So it's not necessarily just an intimacy desire, but the desire of the woman to take over, to be the ruler. And yet that's not what God designed. Now, women, could you be an effective ruler? Absolutely. Could maybe you do it better than your husband? I don't know. I'm not in your house. However, let me put it this way. God designed you so capable, so strong, so smart, so intuitive, so imaginative, that you were the one that he designed to literally be the topping of his creation. So you are really that good at what you do. know what? Even though you are that amazing, you are literally the perfect topping to creation, he is to be the head. Now, what is this not? Submission is not. I wanted to look up and see online what people thought of submission. This is a disturbing man. I listened to about 2 minutes of his spiel. He is crass. He is crude. He is not talking about his wife. He is talking about all women. First of all, submission, ready? Submission is, first of all, this is really important. Submission is not for men to all women. So women, you're not to submit to all men. All right? It's going to say in a little while, submit to your husbands, not to all men. So if a man in this church comes up and tells you to do something, then you may wish to be gracious and loving if you're my brother in Christ. But otherwise, uh-uh. All right? Yes, ma'am.
But are we supposed to submit to the elders of the church?
We are supposed to submit to the elders of the church, but there is a... And I'm going to give you a great example of this. So
I'm supposed to submit to the elders of the church.
Yes, the church.
I submit to him.
Right.
So what if I do something that was against what he said, but one of the elders told me to do it? I'm not responsible to the elder. I am responsible to him. To my God, I'm responsible to him. All right? So here's this is a great example. Come on in, Paulette. So
on this side or
you can sit anywhere
just
you want.
People just been filtering in. All right. You can sit wherever you like.
So here's one of the beauties of it already. I am about 8.5 months pregnant. Hormones are going like crazy. My husband, who had just, he was on one of his half days at work. He was working 13-hour days.
Yeah.
And then the fourth day, he would work only about 8 hours. So he had gotten home. I was just starting to walk again. I had been in a wheelchair for about 6 months, 7 months of this pregnancy. And I'm just actually starting to get up and moving again. This is our first pregnancy. And literally, I feel good enough that day to start. And I go, honey, is there something that you would like? No, I've been in bed for 6 months. I am ready to get up. And he was home. He was exhausted. He goes, could you grab me something to drink? I am just really thirsty. And before I even hit the bed, I didn't even think about it. But now I'm sitting in bed. Could you get me some water? Sure. We were living at my parents' house. Why? Because my house is in South Carolina. We literally came down here and lived in my old bedroom so we could see the doctor that would allow Andrew to be born. Because everyone in South Carolina said, this kid can't be born. It's not going to work. And so we came down here so that Andrew could be born. And I'm pregnant. And I leave my old bedroom where we're living on a pull-out couch. And the very next room is my dad's study. And my dad is in that room 12 hours a day studying the Bible on a conservative day. All right? And he comes out and he says, by the way, Sky, would you get this done before you... before your mom gets home or something like that. I've now just been given two directives, right? Now, being brought up the way I was, you submit to your husband, but you always started submitting to your father, right? And so I'm literally there in a hallway with a conundrum. Do I get the water first, or do I do this first? Now, if I wasn't 8.5 months pregnant, I just would have done both and not had a problem with it. But the hormones going, I did not know if I was supposed to honor my father or submit to my husband. And in my moment of hormonal crazy, I just slumped to the floor, 8.5 months pregnant and all, and just started bawling. Both of them come out of the rooms. What's wrong? We hear Sky, something's wrong with Sky. Are you in labor? No, you both told me what to do, and I don't know who to obey. And my dad starts cracking up laughing. You can see my dad now has tears rolling down his eyes, and he's belly laughing. He goes, honey, he goes, always, this is the one rule in your life. Ready? Submit to your husband. He knows if it's contrary to what I'm saying, he always comes first. You put him first, and you will have the best marriage. Submit to your husband. And I'm standing there like, well, now both of you can go do whatever it is you wanted me to do, because I'm done. So Ephesians 5:22-24. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. Not to everyone else's husband, to your husbands. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body of which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Let's talk about what this means. Let's talk about what on earth this is.
What do you want to do?
Not yet. What submission isn't, all right? How can you possibly sit there for hours and watch me work? And he says, the toughest part is to just sit here quietly and not offer my constructive advice. position is to be berated or to be talked down to be yelled at, or even to be physically harmed, that is not submission. That is nowhere near biblical submission. The concept of submission is also not... most dangerous lines in the whole movie, alright? He's the head. Alright? And it's like me saying, okay guys, kids, daddy's the head, but you're going to obey mommy because mommy's got the pants on. Alright? And that is also a dangerous view. It's not lip service. The concept of submission is not, I can just bend him to my will, which, if we look at a lot of the tragic marriages in the Bible, you're talking about Jezebel, you're talking about Delilah and Samson, all of these things, that's exactly what it is. You're talking about this woman that bends her husband to her will. And it's a dangerous will. Now, you think, but if I do it, it's always good. It's always for our best. It's for the best for the kids. Because I happen to know what I'm doing. The concept of submission is simple in one way. I'm not coming to the table with Lance, and we're going to be very sort of brutally honest in how we do things. When we have an issue, we will discuss. And I will tell Lance, I'll give him all my ideas. I said, this is why I think this is. Now, submission, I have to say, Lance makes submission ultimately easy. I believe personally he's the easiest man.
That's my job, by the way, in this whole process. So out of all this guy's been doing this whole talk, my whole job is to make this an easy process. You know, I do listen to her advice. If she comes to me and she wants to do something, share something, buy something, whatever it might be, my job is to listen carefully. Listen to the options. A, and decide whether she's either right or whether it's worth getting involved in. Because she is a smart, confident, strong woman. I don't need to sit there and narrate, well, you have to do this and you have to do that. That's not my job. I don't have to sit here and micromanage her. That's not what God meant it for. It's to look at the big picture. You know, is this the overall direction that we want to go? Is what she's having something that's not feasible. That's it. It's not to go crazy and sit here micromanaging. That's not what I'm supposed to do. So most things, I'll tell you that most things, I either just don't either share my opinion, like let her make the decision, or don't get involved. Because she's smart. She can handle it. Very, very rarely do I share or say that he's the one way or the other.
I wouldn't say don't share, because we discuss a lot
of
things.
Well, no, yeah, because I share my opinion on it. I'll say what I think. And then most of the time, you'll either go with that or it's not something where I'm taking, we need to decide on.
Can I go back to the PowerPoint?
Yeah.
So, another one is the idea that we've said it's not lip service, it's not submission isn't being a doormat, submission isn't, All right, what does submission look like? All right, in our home, we have different jobs that we do. Alright, he is not ever allowed to touch laundry. That is a major rule. Once he has destroyed the garments, he was taken off of laundry duty forever. I think I shared that with you a couple weeks ago.
Just recently I was trying to get involved. So how do you, is there anything else you could do?
I love you so much, but please don't touch the laundry.
Okay.
He does silverware. I can't stand doing the dishes because silverware, I'm there for an hour getting all the little things off. It bugs me to have anything dirty coming out of the dishwasher. So the dishes get washed before they go in the dishwasher because the dishwasher is meant for decontamination purposes. Yes, someone who gets me. So all the stuff comes off. He is amazing at that, and he's fast, much faster than I am, and everything comes out spotless. So that is definitely a thing that goes to his end. Now, here's another part of it. Submission also does not mean when your husband says something and he doesn't act fast enough that you take it over. Okay? So, those dishes pile up. He didn't feel like doing them the night we used them. Now I'm sitting there doing the dishes just piled up. Now I'm not going to be able to make breakfast in the morning. And so I just sort of sneak over there, and I'm just kind of like, you going to do the dishes? I'm really sort of tired. No problem. Don't worry about it. Okay. And I turn the water. Please stop doing that. The dishes. I got to cook in the morning. or I gotta get something. I have to be able to at least get a bowl in the morning. So, cooking, honey, I said I'll do the dishes, you leave it to me. Now, ready? This is not easy. Submission leaves it to, he's actually told me, this is my job, even though I don't feel good tonight, I'm gonna be doing it and you won't be. Submission was leaving those dishes in there, not till the next morning, to the next night. That was submission. And those weren't easy. Submission is, and I like this
which
one.
Which was not the right way to handle it, but.
Well, no, because I listened.
Yeah, no, if it was the right way for you, I should have stepped up sooner.
But that was not part
not
of
the point.
That, my submission is not relegating to him what he's supposed to also be doing.
You listened, but how, were you freaking out?
Early in our marriage, yes. Early in our marriage, absolutely. That first 2 years was sort of like, okay, I'm really trying to submit to him, but you're making it a little hard on me. And after a while, I started getting a better picture of things. Guess what? My laundry piles up. It's okay if his dishes pile up. Okay? It was really okay. And in the big scheme of things, and that's what we've learned over many years, the house will still be here tomorrow.
On the other hand, I don't give her a hard time.
Ever. He will every once in a while come in and say, I'm getting sort of low on boxes. You think maybe you took a load? And I'm like, sure, now I know that there's something that needs to be done. I got it. And everything else will go on the thing. All right, I'm focused here. So we have come to a really good understanding. The things that make me crazy. I don't think we have ever, in 17 years, had a fight about money. That is just not one of our issues.
Food? Every week.
Food almost daily. but money, no. I saw this great example of my mom never really worrying about money. My parents never really argued about money. And so it was never an issue with us to argue or stuff about the money. However, at one point, I was getting overwhelmed doing the finances.
We know that it's a big deal for most people.
And he said, I'm going to take over the finances. Now, that did flip me out a little bit because I'm also a control freak. I'm a homeschool mom. When I'm on the plane, since I was a pilot at 18, I want to be flying the plane. If we're going to go down, I want it to be my fault. You know, I prefer driving, but I still let him do the driving. Okay, so
this gets interesting in the mountains when she's ready to, like, you know, kick me out of the driver's seat.
Yeah, I'm going, you're really getting close to the edge. Can I drive my car? It's my car. Can I drive my car? And he's going over the edge, and he's like, oh, look at the Great Mountain. And we're starting to edge closer to that 3,000-foot drop-off. And I'm sitting there like, I'm about to crawl into the driver's side with him in it so I can drive. All right?
Never mind, we make it home safely, but that's not the point.
However, money has not been ours, but food all the time. Sweetheart, I know that sometimes you don't feel good. What is it you'd like to eat? Whatever you want. I don't know, what do you want? My entire family makes fun of us on this one, because you guys will be 90 and still arguing about what you guys want to eat.
Yeah.
So, ladies, if you know what you want, just go ahead and I'll tell you this. Tell it to him now, because when he finally does give you the suggestion that's not what you want, he'll go, but I finally made the suggestion. So just tell him ahead of time what it is you really want. That makes it so much easier for him. Let me tell you our biggest one, taking the last word. All right. Early on, because I was a debate captain for 4 years in high school, and then I debated in college. So when it comes to words.
And I'm communication impaired.
He is.
Genetically.
He is. In college, the end of our college, when we started dating, I would edit papers. I'd be like, honey, you need a comma or a period somewhere in the paragraph.
Complete sentence,
you know. That would help. However, programming languages, he has so many of them, I can't, you know, I don't know them all. Right? So he's computer, mathematics, I'm words. And with that in mind, it means that when we come to a verbal argument, that's words, if with mathematical he'd win, right? But since it's words, he knows he'll never win. Right? And he knows that ahead of time. And I know that, but I don't want to do that to him because I love him. This is my gift from God. So what do I do? We sat down probably, a few weeks before we were married? And I said, look, when we have a discussion about things, God's given me a brain. And if I'm truly going to be your helpmate, then I'm going to want to discuss with you things to help you in every way possible. Maybe to see sides that you didn't see. Maybe show you different alternatives you didn't think of. And he said, well, that's what a helpmate is supposed to do. That's what a wife is supposed to be. I said, however, I know me. I know that I will have already come to the conclusion before you even figured out the whole problem, and I will have the correct answer for you. If you think it's not the correct answer, or after we have discussed it and you've really listened to me, like, in other words, not just, okay, Sky, whatever you say, but if you've actually had a discussion and you still disagree, I want you to say these words. Honey, I love you. It has to be prefaced with honey, I love you. Okay? Because otherwise it makes it a little rougher on the edges. I'm taking the last word. And at that moment, that was my clue word. I need that. You know those people that need a 2x4 up the head to get something through their head? That's me. Because I am like a steamroller at times. It served me well of all the pursuits that I've done in life. But in marriage, I didn't want that to be the thing because I didn't want to steamroll over again. Just, honey, this is my gift to you in our marriage. I'm giving you the last word. Anytime that you think it's really important, anytime that you think that you are correct, because I love my God, I love you too, but because I love my God.
And it had better be worth making hurt feelings over. Because there could be hurt feelings over, at least initially. So I have to look at this and go, is this something that I feel is important enough to have my wife have hurt feelings with me, even though I know it's right? And it's not a hard thing. And I can say that I've only done it 3 times ever in our marriage. But I have done it, and she did listen. I tell you, one of them. Come to South Florida to go to the doctors to have my son. She didn't want to leave.
We came down here. I didn't want to move.
Yeah.
Because remember, I didn't want to, I said, I'll never do 3 things. I'll never live in South Florida, I'll never be a teacher, and I'm never going to Africa. I was afraid of malaria.
2 or 3 so far.
And 2 or 3 any day now.
Three times.
He has said, honey, and he's listened. We actually sat down, whether it be over some hot tea, and we would actually discuss, these are the pros, these are the cons, this is where I believe, this is why we should do this course of action. And he goes, you make a valid point. Honey, I love you. I'm taking the last word. Those were not easy words. Because what he didn't say when he said we're leaving South Carolina, is that, honey, we're selling our home. A home that was, you know, already done and set up, and it was our actual house. Not an apartment, it was our first house. And it was my career.
My job.
Everything I had built up for 3 years was there. All of the inroads I had made with various schools in the area, everything I had built up over the years, all of it was there. And so I was walking away from all the work I had done. And I was like, no. We can just have the baby and then come back. I don't want to do this. And it wasn't just to have Andrew. At the end of that time, he says, we're going to sell the house there. We're going to move down here. I said, I don't want to live here. And he goes, this is where you need to be. This is where you need to have your family around you, and all your family is here. All. I love it, but I don't want to be here. And I told him all the reasons why. This was better for us to be there and to be alone. And I brought in Bible verses. I mean, I had my debate ready to go. And I mean, I had, you know, a 6-point outline of all the reasons why. And I had to look at him and say, babe. And he looked at me and said, honey, I'm taking the last word. And all of a sudden, ready? This is how I love my God. And I closed my mouth. And yes, I went in the other room and bawled my eyes out. Was I going to be happy to be near my family? Of course. Was it the right decision? Yes, it was. Hindsight. But the idea of walking away with everything I had worked so hard for so long, it was so difficult. Now, ready? This is the other part of that submission. When I walked back after crying, not to hash it, not to beat him over the head with it. The first time something went wrong down in Florida, I told you we should come down here. Right? You know what I'm saying? True submission is accepting what he said, not because he's always right. And this is the next one.
Yes.
All right? Not because he's always right. It's because my God is that good. All right? Well, what happens if your husband isn't right? What happens if your husband isn't a Christian? What happens if your husband is doing things that you know are wrong, right? In the same way, you wives, be submissive to your own husbands so that even if any of them are disobedient to the word, they may be won without a word by the behavior of the wives as they observe your chaste and respectful behavior. So you're telling me, God, that if I love you so much that I submit to him even when he's wrong, even let's say he's not a Christian, even if he was a God-hater, if I submit because I love you and I submit to him, and that does not mean submission to do evil things. He says rob a bank, you don't rob a bank. If he says to submit to do something evil, you don't cross that line. But if I'm submitting to a husband, it's even an unbeliever. God says that's a testimony to that unbelieving husband to bring him close to the Lord. How precious is that? That submission is that strong. So are you telling me that as a woman, think about it. The number one marketing advertisement tool in America is sex, right? Why do you think they have all the gorgeous looking women around every car sales show ever, right? Right, anytime they want to sell something, they put on someone gorgeous because that sells. So are you telling me though that God's version of power is not the sex sells, but rather submission sells? Submission. My submission to him is going to actually make more of a difference in our marriage, mm-hmm. and more of a difference in him getting closer to the Lord than anything else that I can do. Wow. That's powerful. That's powerful. And that's what we were created for. We were created to bring him closer to the Lord. Just like last week when he was talking to the gentleman, that his job was to love me so much that he brings me closer to the Lord. That's his job. So, what does the submission look like? This one was, someone had asked us recently about feminism. I was a young 19-year-old man and said, well, Miss Sky, what do you believe about feminism? And I'll tell you what I said in a minute, but this was great. I love picking flowers on such a lovely day. I do too, Mom, but it makes me aware how fast the world is changing. I predict that someday women will have the same rights as men. Won't that be great? I'll say we'll be entitled to drink and be boisterous all night long at the tavern. We'll be able to challenge our opponents to duels to the death. And we'll also be able to go off and fight long and bloody wars. Let's go make some cookies and clean the house while we still can. And the last one is that video. I'll get that ready in a moment. So what is submission? Submission is, and this gentleman said, Miss Sky, are you a feminist? Now, this is before I looked up. I thought, this made me wonder, what actually is feminism? I didn't realize the term was coined in the 1890s. That's quite a happy time ago. The idea was women that were oppressed that wanted to gain independence, gain freedom. When he asked me, my view of feminism is a little different. He said, Miss Sky, are you a feminist? I said, absolutely. He goes, well, how are you a feminist and a Christian? That doesn't make sense, Miss Sky. I said, well, are you telling me that my God didn't make me amazing? My God made me to be his perfect helpmate. He didn't need a fly. He didn't need a dog. Even though some people think it's dogs are man's best friend. Okay? He needed me. I am the one person on the earth that was created for Lance. I'm actually the only one for him. I am the wife designed for him, even playing video games with him. I am the wife designed for him to be his playmate, his best friend, his intimate lover, his confidant, give him wisdom and counsel, even sometimes to argue and clash so that he can get ideas through his head of what he wants to accomplish. That is, I am his perfect companion. I said, am I anything less than a man? No. I am his perfect. I'm his perfect helpmate because my job in life is to make him the best that God created him to be. And sometimes that means that his will needs to go before mine. Because, ready? This is awesome. I am answerable to God by submitting to him. He is answerable to God and how he's going to treat me, how he loves me, and how he makes the decisions for our family. I am much happier with my position than his. Right? Because he has to answer for everything that happens on in our house. The only thing I'm having to answer for is how I submitted to him. That's one thing. That's pretty good. But he's responsible. What's going to happen with the kids? How did I love my wife? How did this all work together? But if I love him, I know that also God will grant us grace. Because we have picture after picture where a woman in the Bible is submissive to her husband, and he's making some stupid mistakes. I mean, Abram is like, here, honey, tell me you're my sister. Not a total lie, but you know, you're also my wife. You failed to mention that part. She's taken into Pharaoh's custody. Oh, you know, she'll be one of the harem. And God says, you know what, honey? You were submissive to your husband, but I'm going to protect you, and all of Pharaoh's household is going to have issues. Why? Because you submitted. I'm going to protect not only your husband, I'm going to protect you. You're your submissive wife. Think about the protection, the role that you have in submission. It is not to be endured. It is rather to, you know what, I'm coming alongside here to help, but there are times, right, this is the hard part, to overcome that sinful desire to rule. So next week we're going to be on to communication. So to give you a little tiny preview of why is men and women issues so difficult to get through, we're just going to play you a little tiny bit of this.
Hopefully it's loud.
I'm more like a man. Men are so honest. So thoroughly square, eternally noble, historically fair. When you win, we'll always give your back a pat. Why can't a woman be like that. Why does everyone do what the others do? Can't a woman learn to use a head? Why do they do everything their mothers do? Why don't they grow up? Well, like their father instead. Why can't a woman take after a man? Men are so pleasant, so easy to please. Whenever you're with them, you're always at ease. Would you be slighted if I didn't speak for hours?
Of course not.
You'd be livid if I had a drink or two?
Nonsense.
Would you be wounded if I never sent you flowers?
Emma?
Well, why can't a woman be like you?
Sure. So we'll be hitting communication next week. Let's go ahead and pray.